Welcome to Meddy Simplified. Today we are going to discuss a topic called as acute mastoiditis, which is one of the complication of otitis media. Before starting acute mastoiditis, I'll just describe about the complications of otitis media in brief. Which are the factors mainly responsible for the complications to occur after otitis media? So first we'll discuss those factors. The factors leading to complications of otitis media. They are first age. That is school going children. And elderly persons. What happens with these two age groups is that they have a very low resistance, so or poor resistance, so they are tend to get the complications very early. Then the second is low socioeconomic group or poor socioeconomic group. The problem with this low socioeconomic group is that they are very less known about the hygiene of ear, and they are tend to be more easily susceptible to the complications. Then the third is virulence of organisms. Many of the organisms are getting resistance to the antibiotics, so even after giving the antibiotics they are not treated well, so they lead to the complications of otitis media. Then the fourth is immunocompromised patient with HIV, AIDS, or patient of cancer receiving chemotherapy are more easily get complications of otitis media. Then the fifth is preformed pathway. Example: fracture of temporal bone. Rupture in bony canal, rupture in bony facial canal, etc. What happens? There is a pathway from which the infection can spread very easily. As the disease is occurring, the otitis media is occurring of any kind, they just find the pathway and cause the complications because they have an easy way to go. After that, the last is cholesteatoma. So these are the factors due to which there is a chance of occurring complications of otitis media. So now let's list them, some of the complications of otitis media. So they are divided basically into two groups: extracranial complications and intracranial complications. Extracranial is also called as intratemporal complications. So they are basically first acute mastoiditis or retinitis mastoiditis, which we are going to discuss it today in this video. Then we have facial paralysis. The third, Petrositis. Fourth, Labyrinthitis. Otogenic or otitic tetanus, And the last, osteomyelitis of temporal bone. So these are the extracranial, possible extracranial complications of otitis media. The intracranial complications are very simple. Extradural abscess, subdural abscess, brain abscess, extradural, subdural and brain abscesses. Then fourth, meningitis. Fifth, lateral sinus thrombophlebitis, which we'll discuss in the second part of the complications video. Then the last is extradural abscess, subdural abscess, meningitis. The last is otitic hydrocephalus. So these are the complications of otitis media, possible complications of otitis media. Before discussing the mastoiditis, let's discuss something in short about petrositis and labyrinthitis. So what is petrositis? Any infection from the middle ear or the mastoid antrum to the petrous part of the temporal bone will lead to, and causing inflammation will lead to petrositis. Petrositis is clinically presented by grade Nigo's syndrome. Clinically presented by grade Nigo's syndrome. Grade Nigo's syndrome has a triad of 3D. That is, first discharge from ear. Second is diplopia. And the third D is deep-seated pain or retroorbital pain. Discharge from ear, diplopia occurs due to external rectus palsy, and the third, that is deep-seated pain, also called as retroorbital pain. So these are the and the diagnosis is confirmed by CT of the temporal bone. Now let's talk something about labyrinthitis. Labyrinthitis are of three types. The first one is circumscribed labyrinthitis. What is circumscribed labyrinthitis? It is thinning or erosion of the bony, thinning or erosion of the bony capsule of labyrinth. Most commonly horizontal semicircular canal. Then the second we have diffuse serous, and the third diffuse suppurative. That is without pus, intralabyrinthic inflammation, without pus. It can be treated, it can be resolved if treated very early. Then the third is diffuse suppurative. Here what happens? Pyogenic infection of the labyrinth occur. Here we will see loss of vestibular and cochlear function. So this was in short about petrositis and labyrinthitis. Now let's start with our topic of today, that is acute mastoiditis. We'll start from a So now we talk about acute mastoiditis. What is acute mastoiditis? It is inflammation of mucosal lining. Of mastoid antrum and its air cell system. It is the most common extracranial complication, or we can call it intratemporal complication of acute otitis media. The organism involved, most common organism involved, is beta hemolytic Streptococcus pneumoniae. So this is about acute mastoiditis. It is an inflammation of mucosal lining of mastoid antrum and its air cell system. It is the most common intratemporal or extracranial complication of otitis media. Most common organism involved is beta hemolytic Streptococcus pneumoniae. Now we'll discuss about the pathological process. Or we can say pathogenesis. Pathological process. There are two main pathological processes due to which this mastoiditis occurs. First is production of pus under tension, and second is hyperemic decalcification and osteoclastic reabsorption of mastoid antrum. These two processes together cause destruction and coalescence of mastoid antrum, which leads to empyema of mastoid. So this is the pathological process, that is the two main pathological process. First is the production of pus under tension and the hyperemic decalcification along with osteoclastic reabsorption causes the destruction and coalescence of mastoid antrum, leading to empyema of mastoid, which further leads to mastoiditis. Now we will discuss about the symptoms and signs and symptoms of acute mastoiditis. So the symptoms, we'll see persistent pain behind the ear. We'll see fever and discharge from ear. So these are the symptoms of mastoiditis. Then the signs. First we'll see mastoid tenderness. Mastoid tenderness. Second we'll see ironed out appearance of skin. Ironed out appearance of skin behind the mastoid. Ironed out appearance of skin over mastoid. Over mastoid due to thick periosteum. This is the first visible sign. This is the first sign of mastoiditis. After that we will see sagging of posterior superior wall, mediator wall. We will see mucopurulent discharge. We'll see conductive type of hearing loss, and we'll see tragal sign as negative and perforation in the tympanic membrane. Perforation of tympanic membrane. And seventh, negative tragal sign. So these are the signs and symptoms of acute mastoiditis. Now we'll discuss, there are some types of mastoiditis, so we'll discuss them. Till now we have discussed about the possible complications. We have discussed about in brief about petrositis and labyrinthitis. We have started with the acute mastoiditis, its pathogenesis, its signs and symptoms. Now we will discuss about the types of mastoiditis. So basically there are three types of mastoiditis. First we have acute mastoiditis without periostitis or osteitis. This is just the continuation of pathological process. Middle ear infection. Then after that we have acute mastoiditis with periostitis. What happens here that the infection spreads over the periosteum of mastoid bone. The infection spreads over periosteum of mastoid. The root of spread here is venous channel. And the most common vein involved is mastoid emissary vein. Then the third is acute mastoiditis with otitis. Acute mastoiditis with otitis. In this, what happens? The infection causes necrosis and demineralization of the polytrabecular. This is also called as first acute coalescent mastoiditis or second acute surgical mastoiditis. So these are the three types of mastoiditis. Now we will discuss about the abscess in relation to mastoid infection. Suppose we are having abscess in the mastoid, then if it spreads further, then which other abscess can occur? So abscess in relation with mastoid infection. We'll try to make a kind of flow chart here. Suppose we have a mastoid infection or abscess. Now if it is moving superiorly over posterior root of zygoma, so it will cause zygomatic. It will cause zygomatic abscess. If it is moving towards external auditory canal, that is anteriorly. If it is moving anteriorly towards external auditory canal, then it will cause. Then it will cause meatal abscess. It is also called as Luke's abscess, L-U-C's abscess. The abscess which occurs most commonly is periorical, postorical or subperiosteal abscess, which occurs when the abscess moves posteriorly, when the abscess moves laterally, when the abscess moves laterally and erodes the mastoid cortex over Mac Evans triangle, then it causes subperiosteal or postorical abscess. This is the most common abscess followed by mastoid abscess. If it is going inferiorly along mastoid tip, so it can go to the sternocleidomastoid, along sternocleidomastoid muscle, or it can go along posterior belly of digastric muscle. So if it is going along the posterior belly of digastric muscle, it forms Sitellis abscess. If it is going along sternocleidomastoid, it forms Bezold's abscess. So these were the abscess in relation with the mastoid infection or mastoid abscess. Now we will discuss about the treatment. We have done with everything about mastoiditis, just the treatment part is remaining. So now we will discuss about the treatment of acute mastoiditis. So the treatment. First we will prefer giving antibiotics. We will give antibiotics. Usually what we do, we start with amoxicillin or ampicillin. Start with ampicillin or amoxicillin. And we wait for the we wait for the sensitivity and culture tests. Okay, before going to the treatment, we'll just talk about the investigations part. What all we see in investigations. Just forward to explain it. In investigation in blood, we will see. In blood, we will see polymorphonuclear leukocytosis. And we will see that the ESR rate is increased. In X-ray, we will find clouding of mastoid cell. And third, we will do ear swab for culture and sensitivity, just to find the causative organism for the mastoiditis. So we will give antibiotics, we will start with ampicillin and amoxicillin. We will wait for the culture test. Mostly it is an anaerobic organism causing acute mastoiditis. So we will add chloramphenicol or metronidazole. We will do Meningotomy. That is, we'll make an incision in the tympanic membrane just to drain out the ear discharge. If both are getting failed. Okay, Meningotomy, we can do this two treatment together. So, like, we'll do Meningotomy along with, along with antibiotics. So if both this fail, then we will go for the third option, that is cortical mastoiditectomy, that is removal of mastoid cell. So that was all about acute mastoiditis. In short, once again we will review everything. It is the inflammation of acute mastoiditis, is the inflammation of the mucosal lining of mastoid antennas ASL. It is most common intratemporal complication of acute otitis media. The most common organism causing acute otitis media are beta hemolyticus, streptococcus pneumoniae. And then in treatment, the signs which are visible, the first sign visible is ironed out appearance of skin. And then we treat it by antibiotics and myringotomy. If it is failed, if it is not really getting relief very early, means in the regimen of the time, we'll go for the cortical mastoiditis. So that was the first part of the complication of otitis media. And the second part, we will go discuss about the lateral sinus thrombophlebitis and brain abscesses. Thank you for watching the video. Please like, share and subscribe my channel, Meddy Simplified. Thank you.